Proverbs 23, verse 22 is just this one verse. It's there on your screen. If you happen to make the drastic mistake without bringing a Bible, listen to your father who gave you life. Now, your mama didn't give you life because the oven with nothing in it is just on. Oh, then it got quiet. Your daddy gave you life. And you don't have to like him, but your life is wrapped up in his seed. Listen to your father who gave you what? Life. And then it says this, and do not despise your mama when she get old. Meaning a father is supposed to raise his kid to such a degree he has more than enough to take care of his aging mother. That's the proverb. So I want to talk for a few moments from this thought, faith to be a father. Amen. If you're sitting by a man, hit him in the throat and say, you're going to need faith if you're going to be any kind of a father. Faith to be a father. You may be seated. Faith to be a father. Clarence Kellen, he said these words. He says, my father didn't tell me how to live, but he lived and let me watch him do it. Let me say it again. Clarence Kellen said, my father, he didn't tell me how to live, but he lived and let me watch him do it. In other words, each father has a calling on his life to just be there. This is why there's a vast difference in our society, especially culturally, for us to understand the difference between a baby daddy and a father. The baby daddy wanted your mama but never wanted you. Then forgive mother. She didn't know his motives were impure. And you struggled with the relationship you had with your father because your mother and him in the same space is like putting water on a grease fire. Hello? Can I just teach you for a moment? The baby daddy only wanted the mother. He never wanted you. And the baby daddy then is reduced down to one of two things, conflict and cash. I don't want to see him because he's full of conflict, but I do want him to stop by and drop this money off. Y'all got quiet, y'all better help me. Mothers are saying in this day, just give me your paycheck. And I don't care anything about your presence. But there's an issue with that. Because the calling of a man is to be present. Yes, let me say it again, you may not like it. The calling of a man is to be present. Do I have any women in the house that say, why have a man if he don't help you do nothing? Yes, sir. Yes, sir. You got to change your own oil and put gas in your own car. Yes, sir. Y'all better say something. Cut your own grass. Fix the leak under your own sink. You look at him and tell him what Medea said, I can do bad. I see, I've got some sanctified women that know the presence of a man is valuable. Meanwhile, the father is not into just revenue. He's into having relationships. He's going to give his check and pay, but he's angry if you don't let me see my child.
That's right. That's right.
Come on, talk to me here. And on one side, a father can be deduced. But can I say this to you? A father is just not who slept with you. It's who cares for your children. See, now y'all got quiet. Now the women won't say nothing right there. But a father is just not biological.
What is it?
Watch this. The child is not yours because you slept with the mama.
Yes, sir.
Because there are some sorry baby daddies that, you know, that got their groove on. Y'all help me here. But don't have anything to give the kids. Can I help you? There's a book that was written entitled Motherhood, The Uncut Truth. And the mother said, who wrote it, she said this, not being biological related to a child doesn't make you any less of a parent, because being a real parent isn't just DNA, it's in the heart. Y'all gonna be all right? I want to park here and honor all the men in the house who are watching, who have fathered children that you didn't make. Let me say it again. Let me honor all of the men who fathered children that you did not make. Now, ladies, y'all sitting there. Uh-huh. Yes, y'all are. Y'all sitting there. Uh-huh. Like this is a small thing. You slept with some no good brothers who wanted you and not your children. They care. Y'all ain't gonna see. I'm about to go on. They didn't care nothing about your children, and they made the baby with you, but God arrested a real man to come into your life and to help you with your children. Gave you cash. Y'all ain't shouted yet. Help you with clothing for them growing babies and care for them. You ought to give God a standing ovation sometime for the good men he brought in your life who helped you raise your children. Presence. 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 Not under the tree, but being there. I got to work. Well, you can't make all that money. Money ain't no good if you can't be there sometime. Amen. Y'all ain't going to say amen to this. Brothers and sisters, young black boys need their fathers. Thought I had a better response than that. I said some young black boys need their fathers. They need presence and not just parenting. Calling on the phone, giving suggestions. No, I need you to be here. You know how many kids don't know how to just cut grass and tie a tie? Y'all got quiet. Don't know how to just wash a car. Amen. Don't know how to separate colors from whites. Y'all talk to me here. Amen. That needs some real fathers that know how to train their children up in the way that they should go. There will be fingerprints on your children all the days of their life. And God set it up to be so through educational systems, through all of these kinds of things. God will set it up. Children will have the luxury of having teachers who care, who love them, who will stay with them and pick them up and buy them things. They will have coaches in their mind. Amen. When there's no father, I thank God for coaches in my life. Times are telling me, cussing at me, telling me, get my butt together. I can make it. Y'all hear what I'm trying to tell you. You have coaches in your life, and sometimes you just got a good uncle. Y'all got quiet. He don't ask you no whole lot of questions. Just give you the money for the kid because they need it for school. God knows how to surround you with some good men. And God knows we ought to thank God for grandparents. Oh, see, I'm waiting on y'all. Y'all not shouting as good as they've been to you. God has coaches, clergy, and instructors. But the Bible does declare that, watch this, out of all of the instructors you will have in life, there's still nobody like your father. Do you hear what I'm saying? Paul noticed that children are destined to survive, yet they need the signature of their father. Don't you sit in here and tell me and don't care that your daddy thinks the world of you. Thank God mother knows. Mother knows how to encourage her. But in some things only daddy can say. In some things his presence. Remember being a young boy and I was getting ready to play ball. And I would be there and getting ready to go on the court. Marquis, I would have to look and be looking around. You know who I was looking for? Because if my daddy was there, it gave meaning to the game. Y'all talk to me. How many know you can go through life and don't have any meaning to it? Because brothers and sisters, 1 Corinthians 4:15 says, for though you have many and thousands of instructors in Christ, yet you have not many followers. You want to know why? Because there is a difference between an instructor and there's a difference between a father. Now, an instructor teaches, but a father travails. See, an instructor will teach you by the book. Y'all with me? But a father will sacrifice and be the book for you. Okay? I'm going to help you with it. Okay? Alright, so you see your dad, he say, well, by the time you start driving, ain't it? Yeah, by the time you started, how old are you, girl? And he laughing at me, I'm 17. You ain't got no car yet, you ain't, girl, you ought to be driving. That's your baby dad. Your father say you're not driving? What do you need? How much do you have money you got? Let me help you get this car. Do you know where to look to get the car? Let me test the car out and see if it'll work. Y'all see this? See, instructors give you a book. Watch this. But your father will bear the cost of love you. Oh, okay. All right. Travailing, brothers and sisters, write it down. Travail means to embrace the pain that is in your life and give laborious effort. How many know it's hard to love you? Oh, y'all see? Y'all, there y'all go. There's some children in here it's hard to love. All the stuff you've been through, all the damaging moments that you've had, psychologically damaged, you have crazy. Praise the Lord. You don't know if you like green, pink. Yeah, I don't like green. Okay, fine. Ask them Tuesday. My favorite color is green. You crazy. Y'all help me. Kids don't know what they want. Hello.
Yes, sir.
They don't know those things that they really need in their life, and they carry around this pain. How do I know that's true? Because in this generation has the highest suicide rate than any generation before us. Somebody is carrying some pain somewhere. Y'all don't talk to me, please. Brothers and sisters, I gotta tell you, a father will get down in the dirt of life and help you turn dirt into clear future. This is what God did in our lives. I said, this is what God did in our lives. God got down in the muck and miry clay of your life. And how many know he taught you how he was a good father? Praise the Lamb of God. Brothers and sisters, I want you to know that God is not only a good father, but how many know he will stand in there and help you get it together until you can get yourself together. Anybody know God is good? Does anybody know God is good? Oh, I wish I had time to tell you how good God was. When I didn't know what love is, he taught me what love is. When I didn't know how to have patience, he taught me how to have patience. When I was getting ready to quit, he told me how to hang in there and don't throw in the towel. I'm talking about a good father. Brothers and sisters, Paul was expressing that just because people speak to you through books does not mean, brothers and sisters, that they will stay with you through the process. Faith to be a father, brothers and sisters, and why fathers are so valuable in our life is because they carry our biology. Do you hear me? They carry our biology. You'll be amazed on how many kids don't have a relationship with their fathers. But watch this. They just like them. Y'all got quiet. They like them, but don't know they like them because the father's never present around for them to learn from them. This is the tragedy of our society. How can I become something different than what was before when I can't see what was before to become something different? Y'all want to walk with me? So biology has divided into five categories. I'll share them with you and I'll get out of your way. Are you ready? The biology of a father. The first thing is his physiology. All right? Why is my nose crooked like that? Why my big toe so fat? Your daddy walk on his big toes. Y'all with me? The physiology is the way an organism functions. So some of us don't know how to function because we don't have that roadmap of that father in our lives. So we don't know the way in which we are to function. They say the difference between colored folks in America and those that are over in Ghana and Africa places is the fact that they have origin and we don't. They would tell you that there are certain things that you have to eat when you're over in Africa. That men walk around and eat fruit and onions and tomatoes. They don't consume a lot of sugar because they understand the way their bodies work from their origin. But what you do if you take a child and put him in a place where he has no origin, then he has to learn from whatever he watches. Monkeys, watch this, don't watch chickens to be monkeys. Am I going to help you here? And this is what we got going on in our society, in our community, in our culture. You have black boys who are watching their mothers to learn how to be men. So we have more sissies than we've ever had in our community. Y'all say y'all got quiet. We got more men with fanny pack bags than got wallets. Now I'm going to throw this mic if y'all don't say amen. And it's all our fault. It's our fault. It's because anytime you snatch the origin from a child, they are left to fend and become who they are by what they learn. Now they won't go ahead and don't understand the heritage of their mother. That God blessed them, brothers and sisters, with long, beautiful hair. Praise the Lord. That's why you need a passport. Take your kids out of this ghetto. Hallelujah. Take them out of the filth of this world and fly them over to Africa and places to see that our people are beautiful. They are intelligent. They are rich. Some of the richest people in the world are Nigerians. They are people of color. Brothers and sisters, that's all I'm trying to tell you is the thing that you have to understand is the way an organism functions. In other words, if an organism doesn't have an example of its origin, then it is left to figure out who they are on their own. I want you to get that. A wise man said, there's nothing worse than a man that can be everything to everyone else except a father to his own children. It's sad when a kid got to hear about their father from somebody else and sit around and ask the question, why he ain't never here for me? I'm going to help somebody heal today. Malachi said it like this, children without their father in this life can have a sense of being cursed, and the only person that can restore them from their curse is their father. If you're a father, you're watching by broadcast in the sanctuary, raise your hand, because your absence of reflection is killing your children. While your hand is raised, I want you to decree and declare that over the next 5 days, you're going to go up to your children. You're going to stand right in front of them face to face. And you're going to tell them, whatever curse that you may feel that you have by my absence, I remove it and I restore it. In Jesus' name. Somebody tell them. Verse chapter 4, verse 6 says it on this ride. Read it with me. May the hearts of the fathers do what? Return to their children. And the hearts of children to what? Their father. Unless I do what? If it don't happen, the Lord says, I'll send Elijah to come and smite the earth with a curse. And brothers and sisters, you may not receive this, but may I tell you this? Most of our society is a curse. Because most children hate their fathers. Y'all got quiet. And watch this, this sounds sad, but some fathers hate their children. But I believe God is bringing a restoration. I said he's bringing a restoration. I said he's bringing a restoration. See, the word curse, let's go deeper. The word curse means causeless, or a kid or a person without purpose. Most children, when they can't find their purpose, is because most of those children have absentee fathers. They don't have alignment. When you don't have purpose, you don't have alignment. And therefore, you're living life where your life has unclear vision. And brothers and sisters, I want to pronounce to all of our children that are listening by way of broadcasting in the sanctuary, if your father has not been around, I want to use my spiritual father privilege to tell you the curse is broken. Do you hear what I'm telling you? Somebody said, how is LeBron James a good father when his daddy wasn't around? Because all of the instructors that he learned from now makes him an amazing father to his son. Brothers and sisters, can I tell you everything you lack, I prophesy God sending somebody in your life that's going to help remove the excuses and the curses that you think have plagued your life and that hang over your head. I dare two or three people jump up out of their throat and declare, the curse is broken over my children. Sit down, let's talk a little while. This is why when Jesus, before he ever began his ministry, the Bible says, and before he ever healed anyone, before he ever fed 5,000, can I say this to you? Before he ever done that, God got off the throne of heaven and began to clap his hands when he came out of the baptism water. And he says in Matthew chapter 3, verse 17, read it with me. He says in Matthew 3, verse 17, Matthew 3 verse 17 says, this is my beloved son with whom I am well pleased. Say that with me, this is my beloved son in whom I am well pleased. Say it again, this is my beloved son in whom I am well pleased. I want to know if there are any children that would testify this morning and say, if I could just hear the affirmation of my parents sometime, it would mean the world to me. I wonder if any kids could really testify and feel free in the service of the Lord to say, sometimes I just want to be affirmed. I don't want to be judged by how I perform, whether I did good or bad. Sometimes I just want to hear you say, I'm happy you mine. Oh, ain't nobody going to help me today. Brothers and sisters, the second part is affirmation. Affirmation is the action or process of biology. Number two, affirmation is the action or process of affirming something or being affirmed. God does this in three ways. There are three benefits to affirmation. I want you to have them. Look what he says. This is my son with whom I am well pleased. The first part of the benefit of affirmation is, watch this, when a father is in your life, he's personal. He's my father. Nothing brings me more joy being with children. And then somebody say, who is this man? And say, that's my dad. No greater joy a father ought to have than a child to feel like he's personal with them. Y'all with me? So God says about Jesus when he comes out of the water, this my boy. Y'all not going to like him because St. John 1 says that he came among his own and they didn't receive him. And I love when parents are bold. They'll say to the school, if you don't like my kid, you'll say to everybody in the neighborhood, you don't like him, but don't touch him. Amen. If you feel like you can't do nothing with mine, bring him right back on over here and I'll love him by myself. Amen. Do I have any witnesses that say I'm personal with mine? Amen. Number two, he says, I'll partner with you. Watch this, a good father sometimes just want to know what you're trying to accomplish in life, and he'll get in there and help you. Because the Bible says, this is my beloved son with. Y'all don't know when to shout. How many know a good father will be with you? He'll be with you. Not in the good times. He'll be with you in bad times. Shameful moments. Praise the Lord. You in trouble. Here you come walking in the door. A father is your partner with you. How much are you missing for that to come? I just need maybe 20 more dollars. But you take this $20 and go on. You won't give me $20? Yeah. Well, thank you. No. You're welcome. All right. Now go on and get on that bus and go back and bring that banging trophy. You can make it. How many know we just need the encouragement and appreciation that comes through affirmation? It's personal. Number two, he partners. Number three, watch this, you are his pleasure. I know mothers got this down, and that is when they see their children do good, they're happy. They celebrate. Oh, a mother will run, get out there and run around the baseball field with you. And brothers have, sometimes we have to admit, sometimes we too cool. I remember one time I was telling my son I had 22 points in the first quarter. That was one game, not the game I had 34 in one half. But one time I had in the first quarter, I had 22. And then my dad says to me, and my cousin says she can testify how hard my dad was on me. He said this, you already 10 for 10 in the first, you ought to have 40. But dad was hard on me because it was very difficult because he had never been affirmed for him to know how to affirm. Until years later, 20-something years later, Becky's walking through and she picked up all of my daddy's bad habits with her daughter. And my daddy says to Becky, while she's complaining about her daughter, and my dad says this, Becky, don't be so hard on him. Take a moment and affirm him. So how many know life will give you wisdom on how to handle your children? Because y'all, we all hate that when we parents, our parents beat us, didn't give us a second chance. Oh, but when the great baby, grandbaby's coming to have, oh Lord, they can get anything. They can stay up late. I don't need a baby alone. You looking at them? Y'all ain't gonna say amen. But affirmation, how many know, is personal, is partnering. And God says this about Jesus, he is my pleasure. I'm satisfied not by the situations you win in. I'm just satisfied as a father for you being yourself. You little short, bow-legged, snoring, bring wind, smell mustard. Right. You still mine. Right. Come on, gotta go up to the school. Yeah. Half beat you. Yeah. Right? Yeah. Cuss you out all the way home. Yeah. Beat you, ground you, take your phone. Yeah. You still mad? Can I just take my time? I'm almost through. The psychology, number two, the affirmation. Number three, write this down. The third thing of the biology of a father is that you will adapt is his behavior. Behavior is the way one responds to stimuli. So I spend time with daddy only for me to do life, and whatever he taught me gonna come out of it.
All right.
Now if he didn't teach me nothing, then when I have to respond to the stimuli that's coming in my life, then I'm going to, watch this, I'm going to invent my behavior from what I learned. So if I learn to just go off and lose it and throw tantrums, y'all with me? Then that's how I'm going to respond. But not when you have a father in your life. A father in your life, watch this, you respond because you want to please him. Might have any witnesses out there. Now my friends who didn't have no father were looking to get a little more trouble than me. So they saying, man, Mike, man, we leave the movies. They say this, man, let's go over Robin's house. They gonna be cooking over there, man, let's go. I look at the clock, dad told me 11 o'clock, it's 10:35. I'm saying, looking at, come on, Mike, you ain't, man, come on, hang with us. I'm looking at them saying, you don't stay with Billy Joe. I take a risk on the key. What I do is I go hang out with them. Dad understand the movie ran over. He don't know how long it is. Maybe he don't know how long it is. And I just get home maybe a little hour late. So I go hang out with the boys over Robin's house, and then we eat barbecue. And all of a sudden we just see this car just go by, and it's nighttime, and we on the porch, and I look over at one of my friends and say, "Was that my dad?" And they say, "Man, no, you in a panic attack." So we're walking back, yes. Within the hour, yes. And all we see behind us, Becky, is a Cadillac with smoke coming out the side of the window. And I thought it was Shaft. Y'all remember what I'm talking about? Dad rolled out the window when the smoke cleared and said, "Didn't I tell you to be home at 11 o'clock? Now my friends are starting to drift away from me. And then my dad, who was a father, watch this, says to them, "Y'all get in the car too." Now they were starting to believe they was going to get the same beating I was going to get, Brother Johnson. They was in the back saying, "Mike, you should have went home." I should have went home. And I walk in the house, and dad had already prepared that I was going to be late. My TV was by the door. Y'all got quiet. My basketball had a knife in it. It was flat. My mother said, "I hope can't believe this boy is saying this. I know she's somewhere saying this." Listen, all I'm trying to tell you, he came to come look for me.
Amen. Praise God.
He looked at me when I got in the house and said, "Do you love this song?" He said, "Because the greatest sign of love is obedience."
Amen.
And you didn't love me enough to override your friends.
Amen.
So do me a favor, go ahead and take off them Wranglers your mama got you from Walmart. Took the little sign and drew a line through Wranglers so your friends wouldn't see it. Go on and take them off. I need to holler at you, please. Because a father not only cares, he corrects.
All right.
And the third thing about a father is not only he cares, he corrects, but he must show you he crazy.
All right.
I had such an attitude from some situations of life. One day, talking back, my daddy grabbed me by my neck. Raised me off my feet. He said, "I'll kill you before I let you go out here in this world. And you talk stupid to somebody and they take your life." School up parents, never think children appreciate you for not being in their business. You ought to grab the phone sometime and be crazy. Unlock this phone. Who is this? since you texting and sending these little sexy pictures to? I'm talking about, give me some real meat.
That's right.
Who is this for?
Oh, Lord.
Get in the car, we're going over his house. See, that's a real day. It's quiet. Repeat after me, my behavior comes from my origin. And if I don't know my origin, I can't determine my outcome. Why will Jesus go through the cross? Because he got enough in his daddy in him that he'll see it through. And sometimes our children don't have the benefit of the doubt to be around someone who can persevere and go through the things of life and see those things to understand that in their life they can be better and do better than what they see. Number four is origin. Write it down. Origin is the point or place where something begins, arises. See, wherever my origin is, watch this, I can't be better than my origin. That's what the scripture says. A pupil is never greater than his teacher. You're only as good as the people that teach you. If you don't learn nothing, you ain't gonna be nothing. Whatever you say, what you want to say, but no, that's true. You will repeat the sins of the past and watch this, fall in the same traps of your folks if you didn't learn their origin. We say it all the time. If you don't study history, you repeat it. Origin, watch this, many of our families, origin of faith, origin are damaged because some of us, how many will raise your hand and admit, I didn't start off right? David found that out, didn't the prophet? He said, in my mother's womb, I met up with sin and iniquity formed me. He said, I come out the womb sinning. Some of you can testify you had family members who put beer in your baby bottle. Had freaky and crazy cousins showing you pornography in the back room with lotion. And see y'all ain't gonna be real. I'm gonna help y'all. See, because you gotta help and know that these children are most gullible and innocent in the early years of their life. And you gotta be careful of who is around these kids. Your origin means everything. Brothers and sisters, we ask you all to record. Why, Pastor, you want us to record? I wanted every father to try to help your kid to record something about you. You will be amazed how many kids live under your roof who you provide for, and they hate your guts. I was texting fathers saying, listen, record something with you and your kids. And one brother replied to me, we ain't got nothing good to share. Brothers and sisters, don't take this to be lightly. I'm not screaming, hollering, and pulling that train in. This is Father's Day. And there's a dilemma in our country of fathering men. Here's the fifth thing, and I'm getting out of your way. Distribution. Once I understand, and I really believe, brothers and sisters, that the greatest gift God gave me was to send me to Africa. Yes. God gave me some breadcrumbs. I got the plane. This old black lady. Old man, you look like an Igbo man. I said, he what? You look like one of the Igbo men. Big heads, no booty. You're the big head, but you don't have any booty. You look like the Igbo man. You didn't know us. I said, so is that tribal talk? Suggesting that if every one of you got off a plane in Africa, they would know where you come from. So when I walked in the middle of the service, the Edo tribe was there. And he says to me, he says, Osanagiduwa. He points at me, Osanagiduwa. That God has given thy pathway unto wealth and riches. You are a wealthy man. All right. And as your years unfold, riches and wealth will hit your hands.
Praise God. Hallelujah.
You are Edo man.
Hallelujah.
I wonder how many niggas I got in here. Now, don't think I'm being worried. I'm talking about from the movie where the old lady called the boy nigger all the time. Antoine Fisher. He went all out of life, he had acted out. He just was a bad kid. Nobody wanted to fool with him, and he acted out because he didn't have any origin. And the best thing they've done for his life, they took him to meet his folk. Can I tell you, and can I ask you, a whole lot of stuff has gone on in families. Cousins have gotten cousins pregnant. What goes on there, I'll say that, that's a lie. Kid graduating college, you won't even tell them. They daddy is their uncle. It's quiet, ain't it? See? Y'all don't want me to turn? Let me get out of this. Then you're trying to figure out what that kid distribute. Why is it so deadly? Why is it so hard? See, you took that origin. If you steal my origin, why are you fussing about what I'm distributing now?
Okay.
It's the fifth principle of the biology of a father. Jesus, watch this, he does all things well. Why? Because his father did all things well. And I don't want to talk against the energy that's between you and your parents. That God will remove that from you in this season.
Amen.
My greatest joy is not the prizes of life, but it's the people's lives I am able to touch.
Amen.
Buying gummy worms for Jazzy. She's waiting on me when I come in. And like the typical black girl, she runs and jumps in my arms, kisses on daddy's face. But she says these words, Daddy, did you bring me my gummy worms? Now, I have to make a choice. If I say no, the law may leave. You with me? So I serenade it and say, let me think. Daddy, where is my gummy worms? My prize, my joy. Waiting on my kids to bring me their report card. They're mastering their class, and they're waiting to see what Dad has to say. And I tell them, I have some pride. You're smarter than your dad would ever be. Right? That's only in that moment, Robert, you know. I'm taller than him, will always be smarter than him. Don't tell them when you see him. Right? Point into the kid. No, do this. Don't do that. I don't want you to go out here and leave here and can't change motor off. Don't know how to change spark plug. Get under there, do this. Take this off, do this. I want him to be something. Because there's a lot of kids that got common sense, they don't know how to do that. Hello?
Amen.
And brothers and sisters, nothing brings me that great joy. Having the opportunity to also be a surrogate father. So sons and daughters all over the country call me dad. What a privilege. And all of it has to do, brothers and sisters, with the faith to be a father. Because how many know being a father carries great responsibility? But when you understand that your life needs to be healed in what you do for children and others, that's what I'm doing. And by faith, we're going to Houston.
Amen.
215 pastors in the morning. We're going.
Amen.
With a series of kids, we're going. Because our lives must be in their future.
Amen.
Presence must be what we aspire to do. And I encourage black men, especially in Christendom, who they say are more lazier than Muslim men, to get active in the lives of young people. Get active in the life of the church. Do something that makes a difference.
Amen.
Show your faith that you can be a father.
Amen.
How many know we need fathers in the church?
Amen.
Hello? We need fathers in the church.
Amen.
Stop being scared. Get in the midst of it. How can I help? How can I get these boys together, teach them how to fish? Your life is not over. God ain't sparing your life all that for you to be all in yourself, your four and no more at your house. Learn how to be a father beyond the four walls of your house. You have gifts that other kids would relish to learn from you. All every kid God brings around, and one thing I want to teach them, hard work. They run from me. But if they embrace the hard work, I like to embrace them with gifts.
Amen.
I'm not going to tell them.
No.
But if they will learn hard work, hard work will see you through life.
Amen.
You won't be calling in because you got a floating headache. Get up and go. Get wash, snot in your towel until you get out of work. Make them make you go home. Y'all got quiet. I know this don't make sense to you. That's called hard work.
It's too hot out here. It's too hot. I feel like my I literally waited my door. It's too hot.
Stay out there. My grandmother then would let you come in, and then when they run out of sugar, they would give you Kool-Aid with no sugar and bring it to the door with the flies and say, "Don't y'all come in here at 5 o'clock." It's too hot for y'all to be in here. We'd be out there all day till our mama pick us up. Out there with dust on, no shoes. A baby got a diaper just swinging like this. Ain't nobody changed them since he left. I love y'all too. Solomon closes in the text so I can be good at it. He says these two things. Next screen, he says it like this. Listen to who gave to you. He says, respect the person who gave you life. Now Solomon wasn't talking about himself, he's talking about God.
Amen.
Because your daddy didn't give you life, the seed in him was given from God.
Amen.
That's what he told Jeremiah before you were conceived in there, God was in there.
Yes, yes.
If God don't get in the Luther Vandross, and y'all got quiet, if he don't get in the midst of that music, ain't nothing gonna swim. Listen to who gave you life. So when your daddy go crazy, stay close to God.
Amen.
Learn how to pray to the Father, to God. For Acts 17 and 28 says that on this wise, it says, for in him we live, we move, and have our being. The last thing, and I'm closing, he says, is not only listen to who gave you life, but the second thing he says, lean to who raised you. The Bible says if a boy don't know how to be raised and take care of his older folks, when he becomes of age, he's worse than an infidel.
Amen.
Can I tell you the difference between colored folks and Asians and Chinese folks? Can I tell you the difference between them? Yeah. Asian Chinese, when I was staying next to them down in Sugar Land, I would talk to them at the property line because, you know, they don't pretty much want you over there. So I adopted that. I don't want y'all over here. But we would talk at the property line. And this is what the man was saying to me. He said these words. What are your children aspiring to be? I said, you know, I don't know. They're in between thoughts. I really don't know. He said, well, we just told our daughter she's going to be a chemical engineer. So I said to him, well, is that something that she want to do? He said, something she want to do? He said, she don't have that option. I said, so you telling me if your child wanted to work at McDonald's, just be a good manager, she couldn't? He said, no. We let our kids be whatever they settle their mark out to be. They don't. Jews don't either, who owns a percentage of the wealth of this world. As a Jew, you don't get to decide. You can't work a job less than the amount of money that your mother and father had made. Difference. Am I helping you? So culturally, we allow our children to do less and say we just proud of it. And the man said, when she finished chemical engineer, until she has that job with Exxon or whatever she's using under the name, we won't be happy. Because she has to have, he says, let me say this. He says, I am a retired pharmacist. I've been a pharmacist since I was 18. And he retired at 55. Everything I own is paid off. She has to do better than that, or she's a failure of a child. And she's going to inherit everything that I have. But inheriting everything I have, she has to have her own, that her children may inherit everything she has. She can live off what I work for, and her kids will live off of what she worked for. That's what makes us better than your people. And I looked at that man and I said, and you exactly right. We make our kids start over from scratch. And we don't understand the scripture that says, a good father who is righteous will leave an inheritance to his children's, children's, children's. In other words, when you think about your money, you need to be thinking all the way down to your grandbaby. Amen. Father, I love you and thank you, standing all over for your word.
Eyes haven't seen, and ears haven't heard, the kind of blessings, the kind of blessings that's about to fall on me.